who Deft's best friend from the overseas world is. It's Reckless.
That's
so
true.
Maybe Garen opportunities go up. He better ban that yummy Afreeca or first pick.
Well, they certainly can do that. Of course, Afreeca Freecs, they are got second choice, so KING-ZONE have elected to go on to the red side for game number one. Counterpick strategy has certainly been the aim of the game for this squad, so you can understand that one. And the Karthus already banned away from Cuz. Dread, in fact, having some pretty shocker Karthus games recently in solo queue, so he's not wanting to pick that one away. And the Akali and the Aatrox are going to be taken here from KING-ZONE to start things off.
And Nayeon's got a big smile. So already I feel better about this best of five.
And he was actually not necessarily super smiley Nayeon.
Blue side Yumi ban suggests that
maybe
Deft and
Tucson
do have the pocket Garen bot lane. Oh, blue side games for KING-ZONE will be very exciting. By the way, guys, KING-ZONE with more circuit points decided to choose red side for game number one.
Yep.
Probably going to be a pretty recurrent trend. The only team to choose blue, I believe, was Sandbox and SKT once.
And also, yeah, SKT, I believe, did that in the final as well because they just straight up didn't care and they were just capable of beating Griffin no matter what.
That's
a first pick rise. Okay, which patch are we on again, Papa Smithy?
Well, you know what? Which top lane is it? Because Keen and Rascal do play a lot of the mages, and this feels like a denial pick from Rascal. And probably a top lane pick. Obviously, can be flexed to mid where possible, but Keen is the most recognized Ryze player on the side of Afreeca. This is what I was wondering, because when we were prepping for Final, where would Ryze go in a lot of the playoffs games is questions we'd ask, but because we didn't quite have the Ryze lifers, people just looked past it, even though when we saw it, it seemed really strong again.
Well, this is already very spicy, Pop, because we've got Deft's Ezreal instantly locked in. That's a Karma. That could be the bottom lane already locked for KING-ZONE, and I'm hoping that it is, to be honest.
Yeah, we haven't been a huge fan of the solo lane Karmas.
Oh, well, let's not beat around the bush. We hate them. We hate the solo lane.
Good news is normally they're the pocket counter pick. I'm doing the very Generation Y inverted commas here.
Yeah,
to Aatrox, where you kind of poke him, get some Klepto, and get outscaled instantly.
Yeah.
Tucson does play bot lane Karma, and it is a lane that helps the Ezreal do its thing. And given that Tahm Kench is hopefully now finally dead, rip, gone forever.
Please, God.
Maybe Karma can be a similar response that gives the same sort of like lane presence, but just isn't so nerfed.
If KING-ZONE round out these first two picks with a Tahm Kench,
how angry will you be?
I am going to be livid.
Okay.
Absolutely.
There's a real chance it happens.
I know.
Because they threw them off their scent so they could secure the Tahm Kench.
Oh, God. That's going to be it. Well, Gragas has been locked in here. Dread certainly having some fantastic Gragas performances, and I love picking it away from Cuz. Almost far and away the best.
Yes!
Oh, God.
Get it in there!
No, don't do it!
You threw them off the scent. Tahm Kench is yours. Your beautiful bounty. Yes!
Oh, kill me.
What a draft. Nailed it.
And we knew it was going to happen as well. Oh, God. Okay. Pyke is going to be banned because the bottom lane is no place for fun. And look, I do want to throw some airtime to the Ezreal Tahm Kench because, you know, Deft and Tucson, when they want to win, this is the lane duo they pick. However, it's been nerfed about four times since we heard Tucson talk about it. jungle. We have the idea that the Aurelia and the Karma will be in solo lanes. Neither of those are junglers. So what is Cuz going to be playing?
Hey,
and the Jax is insta-locked. All here
right.
we go.
Now, Jax jungle. We have a couple of aficionados. In fact, in our next match, we'll have Onfleek, yeah. who's kind of the grandfather of that. Marung, the first to play it in the LCK. But into Onfleek and now Cuz. Cuz definitely plays it. Now, the fun thing about this is it's Karma mid. Most likely, we'll get the confirmation soon. And then the Jax, a huge LPL trend is to stick with the Karma mid. Kuro, for example, playing a lot of it on BLG with Meteor popping off in the jungle. Because it makes your jungler a god, usually it's with Olaf, but Jax definitely can get in there and get frisky. So I hope this is Neon just doing his old Kuro impression and just backing up Cuz to take over the game.
Yeah, I actually really like this because the amount of synergy with Arden Sensor is huge on this team.
Oh, yeah.
Because we've got Jax, Aurelia, and the Ezreal as well. So there's a lot of chance for this Karma to actually work in this KingZone comp. And I don't like talking about Karma being a decent pick because I still think that it's crap. But still, there is an idea as to why it was picked with such high priority.
And if you're going to go a comp like Afreeca's, you pick it to Brawl. Because these days, you don't need to think about conventional things like wave clear and late game states the same way because so much of the game is about contesting objectives over and over.
Yep.
A lot of high-skill opportunities open to Afreeca, not a lot to fall back on. And that's usually a sign that we're going to get those brawls, Atlas. And with a Karma, a Vayne, all sorts of fun shenanigans, at least it's not boring. It seems like we're going to have a lot of fun.
Exactly. As soon as there's a Karma and a Tahm Kench, you're a little bit nervous about the state of the game. But these two teams have been brawling every time they've met on the Rift. And I hope it doesn't change now as we get into game one.
Calm down there, Castle John.
The KingZone faithful. Still trying to cheer for this squad, and we'll see the state of this team. I think we're going to learn a lot very early in this series, Papa, about just where KingZone are going to be sitting. Senin with a very early ward here.
Isn't it even weird to consider that of the two squads, the one with the lowest average age of any team in the world? And
this is cute.
KingZone is, yeah, this is a nice move.
Already
Neon's
the
down
Q
here.
Has been mantraed as Senin. Has to blow the flash very early. Def looking for the Q. He does find it, but it's not enough damage.
18 health, I believe, as he ticked up in health. But Atlas, that's the thing that shouldn't be lost on us, is we're so questioning the settled, often veteran KingZone lineup, and we're so sure that Afreeca, with all their rookies, the lowest average age in the world of a squad, is the favorites because we're reading into the tea leaves. We're seeing all the smoke and assuming there's a fire. It shouldn't be a surprise, but it will be a surprise if KingZone are all prepped and on the same page. No one is predicting them for today, and yet, is it a surprise if they do get their act together?
Well, Cuz, you can see these are the Keystone choices that he's gone for. The Hail of Blades Jax to give him some extra early game oomph.
I was going to say oomph as well. Good call. Now, Aiming and Senin couldn't run to lane because, of course, Senin had to recall. So given that, now Vayne and Braum don't have level 1 control, which is not what you want.
And I actually want to talk about the Vayne versus Ezreal thing, because
sure.
we've spoken about this many, many times, right? Vayne, as soon as she hits level 6, can just run after the Ezreal and he dies, is the general consensus on how this matchup works. But I think it changes when the nameplate reads Deft, because this guy generally doesn't sit back and allow you to get to a level 6 on even footing. And you can see already they're positioning very far up this lane. As speaking of up the lane, Rascal already going aggressive onto Keen, but he has the ranged form. A bit spicy on the top side already, Papa.
Yeah, we could see some active trading in mid lane as well. No Kleptos, you'll notice. Karma versus Ryze in the mid lane. Harder for Yukal to set up those ganks because you have to EW, right, to actually get the gap close started unless Dredd is doing all of the heavy lifting. Because his first game in summer was playing the Jax in spring when it was a more common pick. I think the support matchup also matters a lot with the Ezreal versus Vayne. I think Vayne does win trades in a vacuum 1v1, so if there was a solo lane, top lane Ezreal meta, I think Vayne top would be picked into it.
Yeah.
Because KingZone, and like you mentioned with Deft's Ezreal, play so wantonly aggressive and use Arcane Shift for aggressive trades all the time, I actually think that Vayne will have to choose her spots, and without the ability to prep the wave at level 1, this is not going to be a rollover lane for Aiming by any means, And I'm hoping we just see Daft kind of flex and play super aggressive here and then try to make heads or tails.
Well, he's 23-10 in the farm, so already he is living up to your expectation, and largely due to the fact that Senen doesn't have the flash in this lane, so lane presence going to be down for the Afreeca Freecs, but still, I'm going to give credit where credit is due for Dev Cesare.
And Braum is not a Tahm Kench buster by any means, so it's not like the lane, even in the best case with flash up, the Braum would be helping very much. So this definitely is a sort of lane where it's going to be a struggle early for the Vayne.
Well, Flawless Duet not going to land there from Rascal. As Cuz was making his way in, he's just going to clear out the vision after the control ward goes down, and top lane vision control certainly there for KingZone.
But topside check-in for Papa Smithy and Atlas. How did we go at the start of the season? Wow, Rascal, Cuz, and Neon all looking way better than we would have assumed in 2019. However, when the squad fell apart, those three were the chief offenders in most cases and looked like their performance had gone way down in the second round, Robin. So
felt to me a lot like KingZone had lost a lot of their coordination and communication that was looking so good at the beginning of summer. They were a well-oiled machine
that
unfortunately ran out of oil, and maybe they've had a trip to the mechanics and things have been sorted out, but too early to tell at this point in time, as the double scuttle will come in from Dread, showing himself topside. Cuz did give away that he wasn't down there, and that's going to mean a bunch of extra experience and gold going over to the Gragas, wanting to get himself towards the Predator ganks with the level 6 as soon as possible.
And while you're narrating that, it's more severe a problem to the bot side.
Yeah, already running in there, does have those boots, and they get the flash out of Tucson. Flash out of Tahm Kench, a fantastic thing here for the bottom lane of the Afreeca Freecs, as Dread already a successful gank.
But we should ruminate on the point you narrated, the double scuttle coming through from Afreeca. Remember that KingZone have drafted a ganking jungler who can farm up, does scale well, but with the Karma mid lane, you're expecting the Jax to show high agency in the early mid game because he does have a Karma to back him up. To be double scuttle goes against that, so we need to see them use their chess pieces wisely. Otherwise, it'll be the glass half empty of Neon on Karma, because what did we expect when the spring summer season started and Pawn was out, Neon was in? We said, wait, is he just going to play Lulu Karma every game and be a support bot, a shield bot for Deft? That's the glass half empty. The reason the Karma mid lane works in the LPL is because you empower your jungler to be aggressive, getting double scuttled, the opposite of aggression.
Yeah. Also interesting when there's Xiaohu in the LPL as well, and he's been a Karma aficionado for a very long time. I feel like players can skew the champion priorities in regions quite a lot. But Neon certainly does fit that bill, and you can see already doing absolutely fine here in this lane against Yukal's Ryze.
Dread had a pretty poor series against SKT.
Yeah.
Now, Clid was, of course, popping off, but that was the start of his really impressive playoffs. But especially on the Gragas, Dread looked pretty ordinary, so I'm sure he's going to want to show an improved performance. He's ranked 3 in solo queue right now, and we know what his potential is, ceiling very, very high. Waiting for that first cast, it can sometimes be as important as a first Twisted Fate ultimate or one of those game-breaking ults.
Well, Yukal going to be walking over here as Dread's turning up as well, but is Keen going to survive? The answer's no. First Blood goes over to Rascal as the Realm Warp is going to deliver the Afreeca Freecs to the top side, but this isn't where they want to be. Flash already down from Yukal, and everyone dives on top. The Leap Strike, the Blade Surge, and KingZone get two.
Annihilated almost instantly was Keen, and then the teleport was only into the further demise of Yukal. That's a really big moment for KingZone, because remember, Irelia eventually is going to be able to run at Jace, look at him sideways, and kill him. And getting the start here is so important. Here's the gank coming through. No expectation at all by Keen that the jumbo could be tough.
Yep, and also Cuz immediately walks right on top of that Realm Warp, saying, welcome to the Thunderdome. I am going to take you down. The Hail of Blades finally reaping some reward for KingZone. And this is a team that feels like there's new life. I don't want to speak too soon, but man,
so far
coming out of, coming out of the gate this strong, this is the KingZone that we've wanted to see since they were, like you say so often, the darlings of Rift Rivals for the LCK.
If you guys aren't aware, I mentioned a couple of times on cast, had the chance to talk to some of the people around the LPL squad, and they said if it went to a game 5 and they had to elect a team to fight for the fortunes of Korea in the Rift Rivals, they were going to select KingZone DragonX. So
yeah,
didn't end up having to happen. Dumb One Gaming made their name. Barrels Alistair became so a thing that we'll always talk about and remember and reminisce on. But if it hadn't gone the way of Dumb One, KING-ZONE were going to represent because of their wonderful form at that tournament. It was only after the tournament the wheels really fell off.
Yeah. And I'm starting to feel a little bit guilty, Papa. And it's because I got so upset about the Karma pick. And now, the more I'm looking at this KING-ZONE composition, I feel like if you're ever going to pick Karma in a solo lane, this is precisely the composition that you would put it in. And the Tahm Kench as well feels like it fits. But with so many divers and so much of KING-ZONE's ability to just buff up their team with the Inspires, things like that, I feel like Tahm Kench being able to rearrange aggro, to use a weird term, would be really powerful in these early to mid-game skirmishes.
But as a previous educational psychologist, I want to tell you, my young summer child, stay in touch with that anger emotion. Because just because KING-ZONE have done it well, that just doesn't mean other teams get a pass. Because I think your initial feeling was correct.
Thank you.
I think in this case, KING-ZONE have used it very well and will keep it a KING-ZONE thumbs up, but a very much conditional thumbs up for KING-ZONE.
All right, we'll keep the hinges oiled on this particular thumbs up. It might be falling relatively quickly. All right. KING-ZONE looking to see whether he can keep that thumb in the upright position.
Remember they flexed Karma in order to get Tahm Kench on 916.
I know, it was so bad.
And yet,
oh god,
any draft can work out.
That's true. If you believe hard enough, anything's possible, Papa Smithy.
Now, one also thing to consider is if you think about KING-ZONE's champions and think about late game scenarios, not the best comp at dealing with a Vayne. Not a lot of hard crowd control here that's easy to hit. So there is always the flippy-floppy outplay potential from Vayne here.
I do need to be a play-by-play for a moment, Papa Smithy. So make sure that you do put me in my place after this point.
Oh,
but
you know I will.
Karma has been picked, and she's been recently readjusted to have her W view stealthed targets.
That's true.
So if he's able to get that onto aiming in a team fight, then theoretically that's their way of dealing with a Vayne in inverted combo. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, there are certainly a lot of problems for KING-ZONE when it comes to taking down aiming in the late game.
Funnily enough, if you think about it in a sideways way, Vayne was actually indirectly buffed in a huge way, because actually if you talk to pro players, the hardest counter to Vayne compositionally was Ryze, because Ryze mid-ranged, Vayne mid-ranged, about the same range with like W and Vayne's auto, Vayne just, you know, Ryze just presses Rune Prison and then Vayne's kind of screwed, right?
Yeah.
And they can't take a standing damage trade with Ryze. The Ryze changes actually make Vayne's life easier because it's harder to hit her, right? You have to EW rather than just W.
That's
in this
true.
Case, they're on the same team, but I'm just saying, holistically, thinking back, maybe the Vayne meta's around the corner.
Oh my goodness.
Worlds coming, baby.
And Uzi just qualified for Worlds.
And you know what? He's going to play Vayne at Worlds.
I assume he probably will. In fact, I just need him to play Vayne and Lucian, and then RNG can feel free to lose. Like, that's absolutely fine. That's what I expect out of Uzi.
RNG a kind of League of Legends analyst comfort food, because don't worry, they play exactly the same as they always did every meta. It's still everyone bends over for El Presidente to try to carry the game.
That's Uzi, by the way, guys. If you guys are playing at home and you're a little bit confused, he takes everything from everyone. Please stop bad-mouthing the solo lanes of RNG, because they're not allowed to play the game. They're delivering the game to Uzi every single time. It's going to be really interesting, though, because this is going to be a world where RNG are not going to be facing off against Gen G. It's been so many years in a row that Gen G and RNG have been there together. And now, thankfully, we do have Core JJ, but we don't have the rest of RNG. The rest of Gen G and the organization themselves. Rift Herald is going to be taken and thrown down topside as the Realm Warp is being delivered to Neon. He's going to get into the brush. The flash from Yukel, though, is going to be the follow-up as Neon taken down where he stands. And KING-ZONE not able to follow up on the gank attempt onto Neon there on the topside.
So one plate goes for the begging, but the two other plates were picked up by the Aurelia. We saw the plus 320. Rascal sticking around to try to get a solo kill on someone as Dredd tries to close the gap.
Not going to be able to.
Still, they lose most of top lane turret in order to get the single kill onto Neon. And remember, it was a trade of Summoner from Yukal, so the potential for the Jax to return. Let's see what it means bottom lane.
Yep, aiming has hit level 9 here. It's not quite the level 6. That would have been the earlier option as Def. True Shot Barrage lands onto center. Neon's going to turn up. Teleport in from Yukal. Remember, doesn't have his flash as Neon might be in trouble now as well. Rascal's going to turn up. Vanguard's Edge is out. A lot of damage being done as Tucson is going to be able to save Rascal in the nick of time. He's got the Grey Health that he can eat and isn't going to have to as the barrel comes down. Neon does have a shield for himself. Don't know whether it's going to be enough though as Aiming's trying to use that final hour. Gets in there and locks down the Karma, and it looks like they'll transition into a Drake as well.
Well, that was a party down the bot lane. The only person who could not join was Cuz, who gets it after the turret plates are gone, but still gets a nice 450 gold for a jungler that can definitely itemize into carry items and be a split pusher on his own. Rascal has also picked up 100% kill participation in the early parts. Armor falls down. Ocean Drake at 14 minutes is definitely very different from Ocean Drake at 5 minutes. So the payoffs here for Afreeca feel a little bit less worth it, as KING-ZONE have the overall gold lead with a Karma comp. And that's the sort of thing that can really pay off in a big way.
This was before the Trinity Force power spike as well for Death did come in. As we're going to check out Neon getting caught here. That's a Flash Root Prison coming in from Yukal. And being able to do this before the two damage dealers show up was certainly very, very good for the Afreeca Freecs.
It's going to be very interesting to see where this game goes as it goes onwards. Very easy to say the word outscale when the comp has Vayne and Ryze in it, but I feel like there's going to be some asterisks to that.
Some caveats, if you will.
Engage is just a Gragas, which is hard to pull off. Realm Warp, I guess, could be used for an engage, but that's tricky. Team fights are kind of what you need, because otherwise Irelia does outscale Jace in the side lane. Afreeca definitely has some tools that can be used well, but the can be used well part with the Afreeca uncertain playstyle as the game goes on, and the fact that they're way better in the first 20 minutes than they are in the last 20 minutes means that there's no guarantee that Afreeca can actually put their draft together and close out compared to KING-ZONE, who, while they have really no engage at all on their team, they have the winning side lane, they have a very strong siege setup, and that's a style they're pretty experienced with over the course of 2019.
See whether they can hold it together. That has been sort of the story of KING-ZONE DragonX in their recent matches. It's whether they can deal with adversity, because that's just not been their MO in the recent times. Rascal moving on down to the river here as Keen and Dread might be routed. Flawless Duet does come in there as Keen boops them all away. The barrel's going to help out there as well as the Afreeca Freecs are trying to work things out. Not able to, though, as Rascal grabs that first kill. Blade Surge comes in again onto Dread, who's going to go down to Neon. And KING-ZONE have fought back here and now still looking for Yukal, who slinks back to the mid lane.
Ladies and gentlemen, let me draw your attention to how to play with an Athene's Rush, soon to be Arden, Sensor, Karma mid. You scrap, you brawl, you get your Ezreal at Trinity Force power spike into the mid lane to start the siege. Too many teams have drafted Karma and not grouped pre-20 minutes. Good to see it from KING-ZONE.
And it's going to be the Trinity of Trinity Forces as well. Cuz is building towards his. He's got his Sheen already built up, and two of the Trinity Forces are already done from KING-ZONE, who are sieging. Like you say, this composition does it well, and they're almost able to take down this turret where it's dead. Senen as well in trouble, as Cuz is just looking for it. Predator is popped there from Dread. They are going to keep their Braum alive, but not their outer turret mid lane.
And I want you to keep your eyes peeled for the last rites, because this is going to be a holy or an unholy trio of Trinity Forces in this game. Aiming, just trying to get his core items and stay away where possible. Do notice that his CS lead has not extended from the side of Depth. It's basically CS for CS between a Vayne and an Ezreal. Waiting to see the build. We are still assuming Rageblade. There's no kind of contract with it like there was once upon a time, and there's a lot of talk of potential bugs with Rageblade around this patch, but heavily expecting that to be the way. You might say, okay, this seems like just a 2v2, but Karma roams faster and Karma roams better when you got scrappers like Jax and Irelia to buff up.
And Dread actually played the start of this fight extraordinarily well. It's why the KING-ZONE members were so low at the beginning, but Neon did have that Athene's power spike for these skirmishes.
Leonard
to turn it around.
Holy moly. KING-ZONE,
they are so strong.
I would say, if I had to put a number on this, maybe like 7k gold ahead, 6k gold ahead, and you might say, okay, I can look at the top pops, maybe it's 2400, what are you saying? But if you look at where the item completions are and you appreciate that everyone uses their items differently,
yep.
Like some people get Trinity Force because nothing else works, some people get Trinity Force because it synergizes so well with auto attack cancels and their cooldowns, KING-ZONE have the most damage per gold spent on the Ezreal here. This is what Trinity Force and Mana Immune is all about. The Mirror Mana transformation not there, but the efficiency of this build is why Ezreal will always be a meta pick in Korea. Aurelia's done with her items. Karma reapplies and team applies Arden Sensor in a way that very few champions can emulate, so KING-ZONE want to take every scrap they can.
Senna in trouble. There's another Vanguard's Edge into the mid lane as Tucson has to gobble up the Aurelia. Depth turned up, though.
Right,
he's
Afreeca.
Got so much damage. Dread has to go golden, but that's going to see his death as he's going to last for a little while, but Tucson eats the gray health. He's going to be fine, and Deft grabs the kill in the mid lane.
Afreeca can't fight against these power spikes. It's the exact time where KING-ZONE want to take any scrap they can. And remember, Afreeca are not honor-bound to ever fight unless it's a major monster objective. KING-ZONE has almost no engage on their team, not even an Iceborne Gauntlet Ezreal.
Yeah, unfortunately, you know, Senin didn't get that memo, though. He was so far up the lane and just engaged on so easily by Rascal and the rest of KING-ZONE. Four members down underneath this turret. Yukal, what are you doing here, buddy? That is not where you want to be. Double teleports come in, though, and they do answer back. As now Cuz in potential trouble. Neon trying to keep Deft alive. He's able to do it for a while, but not long enough. It is now Keen. May have gone too far, but Cuz as well might be falling into that trap and does go down. Tucson a little bit late, and KING-ZONE overstep what felt like a great engage under the turret.
Still the right time to fight in terms of items. However, with the teleports up, they were always going to be outnumbered there. There's no way for Tucson to come and join down. So tanking the turret ends up being folly. They will lose Ocean Drake. Afreeca Freecs not going to make any sort of emergency Baron plays this early. The game stays in competition. You see good KING-ZONE and bad KING-ZONE all in one rotation.
Yep. And the same for the Afreeca Freecs as well. I mean, starting this fight was not what they wanted to do, but keeping track of that teleport from Neon was a fantastic decision to make here. And yes, Deft got a kill, but they were able to immediately answer in this particular play towards the bottom side.
That's a pretty wantonly aggressive move when you incorporate the fact that TPs are up for one team and you get five members bot lane and not up for the other. In this case, it is actually only a 4v4 as Gragas is hoofing it from the base. However, 4v4 when they took 1,000 plus turret damage.
I was going to say, still a 4v5 as there's that big turret guy.
Speaking of big guys, Aiming just got an inordinately amount stronger since the last time we saw him.
Yeah,
he had half a Rage Blade and a Blade of the Ruin King. Now he's a Zeal on top with a red buff. So Aiming certainly prospered there from the level of aggression KING-ZONE chose to use.
See what this actually means for the Afreeca Freecs moving forward. So far, KING-ZONE still have all of those item spikes, but as this game goes on, the more Afreeca stack on top of what they already have, the stronger they're going to become in comparison to a KING-ZONE that are going to plateau a little bit as far as being able to utilize third and fourth items with this composition. KING-ZONE still have the onus on them to get things done in this mid-game. Deft not going to take that Shock Blast damage as they're just dealing with this minion wave. Rascal's going to go back home, no teleport available. Might actually have the Guardian Angel done, because that's a broken stopwatch and a BF sword already there, and he does finish it. Second item GA coming in from Rascal.
KING-ZONE need to get this, make this game about the Siege or about a Baron take. They have a very fast Baron with Arden Sensor, Karma, Jax, Aurelia, and Ezreal. Very, very fast Baron.
Whoa, Deft in a whole lot of trouble. Arden Sensor and, of course, the Athenes on Holy Grail helping keep his health right back up there. But now he knows that these aren't just love taps coming out from Aiming. It's a lot of damage.
Afreeca can also play a Baron game with this Vayne, right? They've got the ability to tank it decently with Ryze soon to be.
Do you really need to tank it when you've got a Vayne that's this strong?
Exactly. So there's the Baron game here from both sides is strong. Remember, also, we already mentioned it, the engage is a Gragas cast and then situational from both teams, really. So it's a lot about we're in the right place at the right time. You have to come to us and potentially make a mistake contesting vision. So even things like who's got the control ward lead on the map and who's got the vision in their pockets to contest it is very important. And actually, Afreeca have the control of topside river. And right now, if you look here, back timings from KingZone mean they actually only just have a single control ward they just placed.
Yep. And the Baron control is certainly there, like you were talking about from the Afreeca Freecs. So I was going to say, I was going to volunteer my analysis of who has the vision control, because it's a pretty easy one to figure out, as Afreeca have got a lot of blue dots around this map. Senin catches the True Shot Barrage with the door. Nicely done, and Triple Trinity Force is in from KingZone. Cuz just finishing his decent clip for a jungler to have it this early, so
still
see whether he can make that one work.
KingZone need a reset, and Cuz has only been backing for parts of his Trinity Force and hasn't been around the same vision score in terms of control wards. He's actually ahead of vision score because he still has a warding trinket, so
yep.
A little bit easier there.
Death has to Arcane Shift, gets himself over the wall. Really cute play there. Knows that he can be safe as Dredd. Jumps on over just to
KingZone are really, really late on a recall. I think Afreeca have noticed this because KingZone haven't gone for a team-wide control ward buy in the last 3 to 4 minutes. So with a vision disadvantage, also not backing for vision is kind of the double whammy of allowing yourself to really let the map go into a very dark state. KingZone need to find a way to refresh. They finally do. I'm going to get some back timings now. But Afreeca can also go back, refresh their control wards. They already have the vision lead. And the moment that KingZone put all theirs down, theoretically Afreeca have another window where KingZone don't have wards to contest and Afreeca have control of the pit.
Yeah. The problem is that now if Cuz is able to do this, clear out some vision, does take some Baron damage here as well as Fusen spits him back out.
He didn't need to eat him. He could have just queued over the wall.
No, he queued into the Baron pit. Didn't want to take too much Baron damage.
Smart.
With
okay.
His leap on cooldown.
Still can do all sorts of little Frogger moments there. Yeah. I'm liking it. Hopscotch.
A lot of different options.
What was your child playground game of choice? Was it Hopscotch? Were you a skipping person?
I liked, you know, down ball and stuff like that.
Whoa.
I was a big down ball fan.
I don't know, is down ball Australia only?
And like Foursquare?
I know Foursquare, and I think that is definitely Australia only.
It might be. Those sort of games were fun. And you know, it's like halfway between tennis and table tennis with the wooden bats. I liked that one too.
Yeah.
Giving away my age a little bit because that was...
People nowadays are like, oh, I love
Switch.
I think
they played that one in
and
the
I don't
Gold
mind
Rush.
The DS.
I don't know. Well, KingZone are going to say, you can have your vision control, Afreeca. We're just going to push up the mid lane. And there's the Mantra Inspire.
Got to be careful about
the
poke,
could be the start
remember.
Of the fight here. Yeah. Arden Sensor going to be propped onto multiple people if they can keep this one up. Aiming, looking for a flank on the Vayne. As Tucson now slowed down, has to flash. The cast comes out. Not able to find anything. Not a lot of engage options now for Afreeca as Dredd. Goes down very low.
They don't want to poke. They don't want to allow Afreeca to reset.
Not going to do it just yet. Rascal still waiting off to the side.
Hey.
Still great vision there.
Gets cheap about Afreeca the Freecs. Scuttle. Steal it away. Scuttle
yep.
Control for a Tom Kench. Another reason to power pick it, Atlas.
Oh, God, no. Stop it. Stop it.
I can't help it. It wasn't me. It was KingZone.
The big contested pick. Maybe it's like absolute five head from KingZone, because next time Afreeca likely to be on the red side, so maybe KingZone will bait them into picking the Tom Kench themselves, and that's the ultimate move.
And while we gave KingZone a lot of credit and they've done some good things, Tide has started to turn a little bit, right? Like, Vayne shouldn't have this many items, but the kills down bot lane made it a little bit more straightforward. Vayne is very, very strong here. It's still triple Trinity Force, allows them to burst and in some cases poke as well. But the lack of engage and the items starting to really firm on the side of Afreeca loses the kind of guaranteed win areas for the side of KingZone, and now it kind of becomes execution between KingZone and Afreeca Freecs.
And it can be really scary because the burst damage on both sides is just really, really high, and one thing that Arden Sensor does really well is give you a lot of sustained damage and the ability to keep yourself alive for extended periods of time. I just don't know whether that's going to happen when you've got Dredd even doing a lot of damage. Aiming Yukal and Keen need no introduction as Deft is going to jump out of the way. Another Devour comes in as Tucson's able to spit people out and lick in another direction at the same time.
Rageblade warmed up and damage inflicted onto the side of KingZone. Deft able to heal up a bit, but he's below half.
Yeah, we need Neon to be here as the siege has begun. Rascal diving on forward, and they're not going to be able to get too much more damage onto this turret. Keen now in trouble as Depth's landing the Mystic shots. Another slow is going to come in as Depth wants to find it. He's looking for Keen, gets the Guardian Angel, and the Devourer's there to keep Depth alive. Back in position now as True Shot Barrage flies across the Afreeca Freecs. A disengage barrel comes in from Dread, and Afreeca now don't have that button to start another potential fight.
But you see that Def knows how to play with a comp like this. He's happy to frontline as the Ezreal, even though there's always going to be trade-offs there. We're going to see something big here. Feels like a Vayne versus Ezreal carry performance is guaranteed.
Yep, now Dread in trouble once again, but the health bars are back up to above half of the Afreeca Freecs. Another flawless duet comes out. Senate has been engaged on Vanguard's edge. It's huge damage onto the frontline, but Yukal able to get himself out of there with the flash. The Braum is dead, and now Keen running for the hills. He's got a full health bar, but no GA anymore, and has to play with that range that he has against KingZone's comp.
And Afreeca are just opting into the 1v9 scenario, and they don't even have their only engage ability available. The poke is real. KingZone's Baron speed, as we talked about, is high. They start with the bait. What will Afreeca do?
Yep, this is exactly what KingZone's comp wants to happen, though. They want to force Afreeca to make a move over to them. Blue Trinket does come out. Now the Afreeca Freecs know that the Baron hasn't been taken. It's going to be a reset for KingZone as teleports come in onto that outer turret in the mid lane. Neon looking for aiming. The damage is high from this Vayne, and they do bully them away from this turret.
Damage real on both sides, as we've been treated to. KingZone can't actually force anything out of Afreeca, and they do lose their mid lane outer turret for it. The ARAM scenario there was not one Afreeca had to opt into, but one that they halted their side lane push to opt into, which is a bit of a rookie mistake. However, when it all is said and done, not face-checking, scouting out the members of KingZone defending around Baron, got them the mid lane outer turret, they were a ramming core. So they still were able to find an objective here. Now we just judge on the next objective, the Cloud Drake, definitely not going to draw too much attention on the bottom side.
Yeah, the Drakes, in fact, haven't been super fantastic this game. As we have a look at the replay, picture in picture is going to show Afreeca Freecs pushing up the mid laners. This is how Senin fell down. That's what happens when Death hits all of his buttons correctly.
His buttons are now even stronger. There is that reset finally from Death. BF sword into his fifth item completion. Aiming himself also really, really strong. But remember, aiming's job is more difficult. Yes, there is a lot of outplay and a lot of hard CC like we mentioned compared to KingZone's comp, but Ezreal has the pocket karma, and that is the champion I always find it hardest to rate in terms of scaling, because infinite mobility and shields and an aggressive mindset can lead to moments like this.
Well, aiming does have the final hour available, hasn't popped it just yet, as the Afreeca Freecs were looking for the fight, but now they don't want it. True Shot Barrage over two. It's now KingZone, they're on the offensive, they're looking for this Afreeca squad, as the Cloud Drake might be started, but it's not the priority here for either of these teams. KingZone want to fight. Afreeca want to find KingZone at a vulnerable position to get themselves a pick, use all this burst damage in a positive way.
Well, we're not using side lanes, so we've got to do here's what we got.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Well, Cloud Drake is going to get taken down very, very low here. KingZone will be able to lock this one down. Cuz is going to take it. Rift Scuttle going to go over to him also. Afreeca now sort of milling about, don't quite have a game plan. We'll just reset here in the mid lane.
That's the reality of this scenario. Afreeca, one of our poorest teams at using side lanes, even though they should have some options here, not using them. And KingZone just trying to group with their Karma, who has a non-scaling build, and get advantages now. That's the reason that the game has degraded a bit from the macro side.
Double lifesteal now done for aiming. He's elected for a Bloodthirster instead of the Infinity Edge as item number four.
You know what that build does well?
Stays alive.
Well, I think it's...
And Baron. And lots of things.
And front lines. Better.
Yeah.
That this is a Vayne who knows she's going to have to scrap up front with not much peel at all. And KingZone have already shown how they're going to play. It's Ezreal up front. It's a Jugger Ezreal comp. Really, in some ways, on the side of KingZone.
Still few options with Rascal and Cuz to cause a ruckus.
And if Cuz gets big enough, you have to use the Condemn to get condemn him away, and then Vayne is killable.
Yeah.
Is kind of the teamfight scenario that can happen, and we always talk about how if the game goes 70 minutes, your Jax just is going to outscale every other jungler that exists because of how his kit works, and that gives you the sort of lead that is almost impossible to emulate.
Well, now, the Afreeca Freecs still with a lot of vision around this Baron Pit. 3,000 gold. No, 2.3. Not even that. KING-ZONE not very far ahead with a composition that wants to be very far ahead at this stage of the game. But now we're teetering. We're at the moment where KING-ZONE can just end this game if they win the fight that they're looking for. And now we've got 5 versus 5 in this mid lane. Aiming does find the front line there. Tucson going to disengage. Yukal can be a hero here. He has death cap and all of his core down. We already saw the 1v3 coming through from Nuggery. Well, Death throws his True Shot Barrage the opposite direction. That was a weird one.
Zoning.
Yeah, zoning,
zoning Barrage.
He's just checking to see whether one of these players instantly moved over towards the Baron Pit when he had vision of all of them not a second ago. Just a whoopsie there, guys. Those things happen. No harm, no foul, though, as KING-ZONE still full health on everyone. Neon does have his finger on the pulse when it comes to the Mandarin Inspire button.
I've got a song in my head.
Oh yeah, which one?
It's What Is Love, but I replace love with side lanes.
Baby, don't side lane.
It's LCK, don't hurt me, actually. Well, they're on the Baron. This is a good call from KING-ZONE. Remember, they don't take too much damage. They can turn off this, but the problem is their turn is a little bit toothless.
Yeah, well, they turn a little bit early there as well as Shock Blast did not actually do very much damage. Neon keeping everyone alive quite effectively as now Barrel flies in once again. Two have been separated, but KING-ZONE able to disengage. Now trying it once again. Vanguard's Edge goes wide. True Shot Barrage does not.
A lot of important cooldowns down from the side of KING-ZONE here. But
not a lot of vision available for KING-ZONE either as Aiming has found the inside track to this inner turret and he's got so much damage. KING-ZONE, they don't want to give this one up. A lot of damage there with the Inspired Q out of Neon. Rascal now able to do some work here also. Deft throws some damage onto Senna, not going to kill him this time. And man, this is so back and forth between these teams.
They're just making it about one thing, which is the 5v5. They're just running at each other, Atlas, and every time a Baron is started, we're just kind of waiting for a mistake. We were hoping for it to be about a mechanical outplay. Might just be one singular mistake. We're running out of vision, we're running out of time. KING-ZONE going to push through mid lane and no control wards in anyone infantry because who cares about wards?
Yeah, I was going to say running out of control wards is another thing to mention.
No one's ever allowed to back. Never. No backs.
Abyssal Voyage comes in from Tucson. He's got some extra vision now as Dread may have found the damage he's looking for. Rascal does have the GA, but it was a decent barrel there. And now a flash out from the top laner. KING-ZONE do take control of the area though. Will now be able to try and clear out some of these wards. That control ward that was picked up there does go down immediately.
Now it's time to start the Baron. They know Afreeca has no vision available that someone's likely to back. Everyone's still here.
Yukal moves on in. It's four members. Has to flash immediately now as Keen might be out of position. Is going to be punished into the GA and Afreeca have overstepped. The first mistake comes down from our blue side squad and now KING-ZONE should be able to get the Baron and should theoretically be able to win the game.
KING-ZONE staying on the rift for so long with no backs but using a teleport to get back is what allowed this. Afreeca had the teleports up. They didn't know to use them to refresh Vision Atlas. Now it might just be Baron for free to KING-ZONE.
Well, Rascal going to walk over a ward here. He's a one-man army against the potential four members of Afreeca as Elderdrake has spawned. It's 36 minutes. The Baron goes down. KING-ZONE are going to be able to lock that one up. And Afreeca don't quite know what to do. Only four members on the map right now as the True Shot Barrage will spot that Afreeca are not doing. The Big Bad Dragon.
I don't know if they've reset or if they're doing some guerrilla warfare around their blue buff.
Oh, this is so cute. It looked like they weren't there, but they've started it up. And now the Elderdrake will be the trade for the Baron buff. So cute out of the Afreeca Freecs.
KING-ZONE understood that they didn't have the ability to check either because the vision was all gone. And they hoped they had backed, but accepted they might give up Elder. Bit of guerrilla warfare going on.
This is a weird
gorilla
game, yeah.
It is weird because both teams are taking shortcuts and also playing a little bit non-standard. I think KING-ZONE understood that in an exhaustion place, they were basically with short rations on both sides, to use an analogy. They were going to be able to last a bit longer. They'd had a bigger lunch, I guess, is what we're saying here.
Yeah.
And that's why Keen dies. Now, a veteran team with a shot caller, not the youngest squad in the world, would have just said, hey, go back and get us some wards. Use your teleport to get back. It doesn't matter that you're not going to be able to make a cross-map play. We're only playing in one lane at one time anyway. But instead, Afreeca didn't have that. They made a mistake around that area. This was the cute moment, though. KING-ZONE are like, do we face check somewhere and give up our Baron, give up kills? It's not safe to do so. We've got no vision. They used two plants and two dreams. Couldn't find it. And Afreeca get the free Elder.
Yep, the Scryer's Bloom was not quite in the right position. The spot where they were doing the Elder, True Shot Barrage lands over two. The Elder Drake means that it's much harder to use this Baron effectively.
What does it all mean? This is, in an ARAM sense, which is what we're going to see, obviously.
Oh yeah,
watch this game. Baron does make KING-ZONE very happy. Afreeca have a limited wave clear, like we've noted. But if Aiming's able to walk up to waves and there's no threat on him, he's not chunked out by, I guess we're going to have to say, Deft only. Then, if you can just frustrate for another minute and a half, I think it's a straight-up win for Afreeca, because Atlas,
as the
guess
game
what
goes
happens?
On.
You go back to that second Elder spawn, KING-ZONE have to fight you for the five-minute buff. Afreeca owning the Elder means that if KING-ZONE don't crack the inhibitor line with this Baron, which seems impossible at this point, I think Afreeca just trade it up, straight up.
Yeah. And the game is going to extend, right? And then Afreeca can utilize their scaling advantages. Now Rascal trying to fight Yukal, and he's going to do it easily. Took a lot of damage. Didn't even need the teleport in from Neon, and this might be the mistake that costs it for Afreeca Freecs. That's why you don't fight the Aurelia at this stage of the game. He's even got a Randuin's Omen and an Elixir of Iron that he didn't have to chug.
Yet it seems like Yukal was confident he could take the 1v1, or we missed some context at the start of the play that would make it make more sense, but Yukal was schooled in the 1v1,
yeah,
despite no magic resist outside of Merc Treads and the extra health coming through from the Sterix. So that's a very big mistake from Yukal to go and follow up on Keen's late teleport. They will lose mid lane in a turret as a result.
Yep, Inna does go down, and now KING-ZONE are looking to continue pushing forward. Def finds a Blade of the Ruined King onto Dredd, who's still taking a fair bit of damage from this Ezreal. At full health, has himself the shield, and they're trying to protect this siege minion. Another minion wave comes on in, and now KING-ZONE starting up this siege in earnest. They've got Ezreal, a fantastic sieger, as the wave clear is decent from the Afreeca Freecs. Dredd, in fact, helping a lot there as the body slam flies forward. Tucson gets himself to the right side of that barrel. Dredd doesn't quite find it there as now Aiming. He's dancing forward but can't close the distance. KING-ZONE are just playing with the Afreeca Freecs right now. Flawless Duet doesn't get a stun. Senen below half health. Now looking to try and go forward. Def in trouble, but Devour is there as in goes Cuz. Looks for the stuns, gets the counter-strike, lands it onto Aiming, but he's so incredibly strong. Cuz tries to flash, but he's going to die. Afreeca, they've got their rise back, and now they've got the team fight. Three already dead, and Neon and Tucson, they can't do anything against this squad. Aiming at full health, having a field day in this fight.
Able to reset aggro a couple of times. Here's the Realm Warp.
Realm Warp comes in. Neon below half health. The flash from Tucson, but he's going the wrong direction. Now trying to fight against Dredd, and Dredd doesn't exactly have a lot of buttons. He gets eaten, but now Keen will be able to close on
That's
the
it.
Catfish. And it looks like Afreeca have done it against KING-ZONE, who managed to get that Baron. They pick up the Elder Drake, though, and they've got a huge Vayne. Going to be able to take down these Nexus turrets, and what an exciting game one to begin this best of five.
Aiming was able to live through that, the double lifesteal to frontline flash out, and return to the fight. And even though Afreeca made their share of mistakes, they're going to win game one.
They are. Nexus is going to go down. They waited long enough. The Vayne got big enough, and Afreeca will lock down game number one in the best of five series.
What a crazy game between Afreeca and KING-ZONE. Clearly, some macro mistakes on both sides, and yet the sort of game that would benefit from a VOD review for the neutral and for both teams.
Yeah.
There was a lot of interesting moments there. The Elder Dragon take was some real five-head stuff around the conditional vision they had with the True Shot Barrage and also the plant. And then the decision from Afreeca to take it was actually a very intelligent one rather than a stubborn one, which sometimes younger rosters can make. I think KING-ZONE largely made the better mistakes around the map, and yet it all ended up being about one fight because the siege comp couldn't do as much sieging as it wanted early enough, and the Baron buff being negated for so long really stopped the onward march from KING-ZONE DragonX.
Just it's a really difficult one to work out when it comes to what this means for momentum in this series, because what do you necessarily ban to stop Afreeca from doing that? You sort of know exactly what you do to change up your game plan against the KING-ZONE comp if you're moving into game number two, right? You know, the karma was exactly why things were working the way they were. It's why we were having a lot of those ARAM situations. But Afreeca's comp is more like, well, we've got a lot of damage.